Symposium is sponsored by the Mellon Foundation. We are very grateful to them for bringing such a wonderful array of scholars to our midst. And so having said that, I'd like to turn to this afternoon's session, the first of two this afternoon. This one is on scripts and scribes. Our first speaker, Alain Georges, has been lecturer in Islamic art at the University of Edinburgh since 2007. Following the receipt of his PhD from the University of Oxford in 2006, Professor Georges has been busy publishing articles on subjects as the geometry of early Qur'anic manuscripts, calligraphy, color, and light in the blue Qur'an, the famous Qur'an of which we have a page on view, and various aspects of the fascinating manuscript, the Maqamat. His book, The Rise of Islamic Calligraphy, was published in 2010. Today, he will speak on a little-known collection of early Qur'anic fragments at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. So,
welcome, Alain.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank Sheila Canby and the team at the museum for inviting me to this celebration of the museum's collections and for the wonderful organization. And my task today is a very difficult one because you've all just had your lunch. I suppose you're all a bit sleepy. You may be tempted to, you know. But I will do my best to keep you awake for the next 20 minutes. Let's see how that works. So this little-known collection of early Qur'anic fragments isn't very well known for a good reason, in fact, which is that most of them are recent acquisitions and gifts to the museum, and several of the most important pieces were acquired in the period during which the galleries were closed. But it's a very high-quality set of early Qur'anic leaves, so I'm going to try to reinsert them in the context of early Qur'anic calligraphy in light of recent research in this field. And it all starts really from very humble beginnings, because Islam is a civilization known for its calligraphy, but you have to remember that until the Qur'anic revelation, this was a primarily oral culture. The primary art form of the Arabs before Islam was poetry, which is an immaterial culture that was, as the Arabic language puts it, deposited in the breasts of men. Now, with the Qur'anic revelation, and poetry is, of course, malleable, it changes with every generation. With the Qur'anic revelation, there is a change of situation, whereby you have a sacred text that at first gets memorized by the companions of the Prophet, but which needs to be recorded in a secure form. And this is when you see the emergence of the earliest manuscripts of the Qur'an in the 7th century. Here we have one which isn't from the museum, which is from the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris. This is just to show you the kind of script and the kind of starting point that you have for Qur'anic calligraphy. So a few key features. The layout is irregular. The lines aren't really straight. The handwriting has got all these slanting, tall strokes. And the handwriting is closer to an individual's hand than to what you would call calligraphy, the art of writing, or in Greek, from the Greek word for beautiful writing. So it's not calligraphy yet. We're closer to handwriting. This nascent material culture of Islam has to compete with the culture of the largely Christian culture of the territories that it conquers, Syria, Iran, and Egypt, and so on. And very soon, they start inscribing themselves within this context in a much more spectacular and confident way. Now, the earliest extant witness to this development is the Dome of the Rock on Temple Mount in Jerusalem, which is built in 692 by Abd al-Malik, who's one of the great founders of the Islamic State as caliph. And this monument also contains the earliest piece of Arabic calligraphy in the proper sense of the term that has survived to this day. It's a 240-meter long mosaic inscription, mainly consisting of Quranic passages and quotations. And you can see the radical transformation that's happened from the earlier manuscript you've seen a moment ago, even though they are separated by just a few years or a few decades within the same century. So what's happened? We have now codification of the letter forms. The letters are very precisely the same throughout the text. For example, this circle that you see here is a meme, so it's a sound M, and it's going to be exactly replicated throughout the inscription. And we have strict principles of geometry that are layered horizontally to create an architecture of the script. And I'm using this term because it probably has something to do with the context of these architectural programs in which this new angular script called Kufic emerges. And so from now on, I'm going to show you a few fragments which are at the museum here, and most of them you can see in the gallery upstairs. The rest you can see by looking online, Quran manuscript. And this one represents still the transitory phase between the earliest period of Quranic calligraphy, our early manuscript, and Kufic calligraphy proper. So what's changed? Well, obviously, as soon as you look at it, you get a different impression. And this is because the layout has become extremely regular. Equidistant lines, which are perfectly parallel, which are inscribed into a near square. And so we're moving away from the vertical format, which had been the norm for Bibles, the main luxury manuscripts of the Middle East until then, towards something more distinctive for the Quran. And you can also notice that the strokes of the letter are much more vertical than before, but they still have a slight slant to the right, because we're at the beginning of this process of change. And you can't see, but it is true, believe me, that there are traces of rulings, which are the lines that scribes use to guide their work in a manuscript. So you have very faint traces of that, which just a few years later, people managed to completely erase in their Quranic manuscript. Now, this fragment here is very interesting because it's in a rare script type. I won't enter into the details of that. And there's only two or three other specimens showing the script in other collections worldwide, besides being quite early, around the early 8th century. Now, there's a great disadvantage to slides. The wonderful thing is being able to show this on such a large scale. The disadvantage is that you lose a sense of scale. This is a giant Quran. It's the largest Kufic Quran in existence, about 50 centimeters tall. And you see the principles that are behind the layout, the script, are still very much the same. But the Quran is becoming a book of monumental proportions that didn't exist, for example, in Bibles, not on such a scale in earlier periods. And this is a very important aspect of these manuscripts. Many of the larger ones are mosque Qurans, which are meant to be displayed within an architectural context. Here you see leaves from a very similar giant Quran, possibly the same, or they're at least produced in the same period, at the mosque of Sayyidina Hussein in Cairo. This gives you an idea of the way that the book becomes a presence within the mosque, and here I'm getting close to what Renata Holod has been speaking about this morning as well, something that's exposed to the gaze of worshippers during Thursday evening invocations and Friday prayers. And we have textual sources about the Umayyad period and the early Abbasid period, about these books being brought from the palace of the governor to the mosque. They're usually adjacent in this period, being read and then being taken back, or being stored in a coffer within the mosque. Try to think then about these manuscripts in a context, an orchestration of ritual which involves sight, which involves smell, with incense that's used extensively in mosques as well. Imagine the flickering lights of candles, which we've seen this morning, and architectural programs that create monuments, mosques, and Qurans at the same time. And there's a kind of mirror game between them at that point. The most spectacular expression of this trend is the famous Blue Quran, which was written in gold ink on parchment that was dyed in dark blue, probably using indigo, although we don't have a very reliable test yet for this. And there's an enormous expense of time, money, labor put on this manuscript. Imagine, for example, that besides the cost of the gold and of the parchment, which is itself an expensive material, of the indigo, every single letter that you see here has been outlined in a thin pen after the scribe had written it. Now, this Quran, which belongs to the 8th century, although there's been some debate about that, but I'm fairly confident about that, echoes the inscription that you've seen a few moments ago at the Dome of the Rock, which is gold over a dark blue ground. And we know that the Great Mosque of Damascus and the Prophet's Mosque in Medina originally had similar inscription in gold over dark blue. And the symbolism here is one of light shining through darkness, the obvious first meaning of the Quranic revelation in a Muslim perspective. And what you see, in fact, here is the transposition of an iconography that already existed in Christianity, where icons and mosaics of Christ often show him dressed in white and gold colors of light against a dark blue ground, being transposed then to the Quranic word, what you could call an iconic calligraphy, in a sense. Now, and I should add, actually, that the museum possesses this leaf from the Blue Quran, and at the moment you can see two others from the Brooklyn Museum in the Byzantium exhibition on the same floor. And so this manuscript is less famous. It's much smaller. Again, slides are deceiving. It's less than half of the Blue Quran. But it's extremely interesting because it's the one of the only known early Quran manuscripts to be dyed, this time in an orange-red hue. And this is a very rare phenomenon, which hasn't been studied properly. And we're still looking for leads, ideas to understand why this happened. But this is, again, a very rare specimen. And there are only a few other leaves with comparable features elsewhere in the world. So the first manuscripts I've shown you have a few similarities. You might notice, perhaps, that their script is slightly different, but they have a square to oblong format with 15, 16 lines to the page, typically. And most of them are meant to be used, as I said, in a mosque context, and they are themselves monuments within the mosques. Now, in the 9th century, there's a change of ethos in the production of Quran manuscripts. You go towards books which have much fewer lines of script to the page and are much smaller. So here, if you count the illumination, you'd have 6 lines instead of about 15. And the manuscript is much smaller. It's about 15 by 20 centimeters. It's no longer this imposing presence in the mosque. And yet, there's still a lavish use of resources. Parchment is much smaller here, but there are so few words to the page that the amount of parchment that's used to make a manuscript is probably quite similar as with these larger manuscripts. A Quran like this one would have been bound in 30 or 60 volumes, and so would have been, again, an imposing presence within probably a wooden coffer in the mosque. If you want to get an idea of the woodwork of the period, you also have very nice examples in doors in the Byzantium exhibition upstairs at the moment. So, use of resources that's very lavish, and you can see gold is still extensively used as well, and something that continues but becomes more striking to the eye, which is the geometry of the page, and the fact that this page is based on principles of geometry and proportion. In other words, there's a fixed ratio of height to width within all the pages of a given Quran. This is very interesting because these principles were transmitted to early Islam by classical civilization in a direct line of transmission, which goes not through philosophers, although this has Platonic roots as an idea, but through chains of craftsmen. And then in this other example, which is quite similar in script, size, format, and so on to the one we've just seen, we see a further development, which is all the colored dots that are scattered throughout the page. And you notice that they're in different colors, red, green, yellow, and there's even a blue one here. And this reflects an evolution in Islamic society. It's the end of this continuum, which starts at the time of the Prophet's revelation, whereby the Quranic text, from being an oral text, becomes more and more strictly written down and codified. So these dots add to the recorded dimension of the text, the short vowels, and some other orthographic subtleties, which I will spare you after your lunch. And they show the rise of a class of scholars, which becomes much more powerful in society in the 9th century, that has this strong power, you could say, through knowledge of the Quranic text. And it's useful as well to dismiss a common misperception, which is that these manuscripts are illegible or extremely hard to read. In fact, once you're trained to read a Quran, they're extremely easy to read. And if you're not a trained Quranic reader like me, but you spend some time looking at them, they're actually not that difficult to read. Perhaps you should look at them as a music score, where some people can't understand anything of what's written on the page. Some people can read A, B, C, D, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, and some people can read a melody, and in this case, recite the Quranic text just from looking at that. And they're a support for an oral process of transmission. So at the end of the period that I'm speaking about today, the earliest period of Quranic calligraphy, which corresponds to the apex of the Islamic Empire, the founding stages of Islamic civilization, we have this fascinating manuscript, which is called the Quran of the Nurse, Mushaf al-Hadina, which is unique. It reflects a new aesthetic of the script that develops in the 10th century from the earlier Kufic, with accentuated angles, but most of all, accentuated contrast between thick and thin strokes, which require incredible mastery of the pen in order to be written, more so perhaps than earlier Kufic manuscripts. Now, this manuscript is of particular interest because it's dated 1020. We know who the patron was. She was the nurse of the Zirid Amir of North Africa, so that's a dynasty that rules the region in that period. And the Zirid Amir in question, Ibn Badis, is the author of a treatise on calligraphy, inks, and pens. We know from a woman scribe who wrote one intermediary colophon as well, the name of the person who's in charge of the project, Ali ibn Ahmad. So it's the best documented early Quran, and we know that it was produced for the Great Mosque of Kairouan in Tunisia, which is itself extant, pretty much in the state it was in back then. And so this is one of the manuscripts with which you could extend the context around the book much more than with any other Quran. And you also notice the role of women, which is visible here, and which is a particularity, as far as we can tell, of the Maghreb, the Western lands in the Islamic world. In about the same period, we have a historian who records that there were 170 women copies of the Quran in the eastern part of Cordoba alone. Quite an interesting avenue of research as well. So this collection of early manuscripts at the museum is small, but it's actually very rich, extremely interesting, and it deserves to become better known. Thank you. Yes, please. Oh, yes, there's a microphone.
You introduced the Dome of the Rock inscription as the first step for the developing of this kind of monumental script. Mm. I have, when I'm looking on different material, for example, coins, the feeling that always we have different. We have the handwriting, we have the very early script which you showed from there, and we have the monumental script. When we look at coins from Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, they have very early on, before 71, so the elongated vertical and horizontal letters, these exaggerated style, and in Damascus we have on coins, let us say, more a kind of handwriting or a roundish script with not too many rules. Mm-hmm. And so that we have, and it must be also in the palaces of Hira that we had Arabic inscriptions, but we don't have them. So physically, in the monumental form, we have as first the Dome of the Rock, but it's so perfect that there were some predecessors there. So
yes. Thank you. That's a very good point. And what I've noticed in the earlier coins is that some have the imprint of Pahlavi, so Middle Persian, in the style of writing, and you can trace the development of this new aesthetic in the coins in parallel to the inscription at the Dome of the Rock. So it happens at the same time in coinage and in starting with the coins of 77. Yes.
What I wanted to say is that even before,
yes.
So on Arab Sasanian coins, we have the miniature version of a monumental script already there. So before the reform.
Yes. Do you have a date for that?
So it's also around 70.
Oh, yes, around 70. Mm-hmm. Well, I'd be very interested in seeing the example. You also see in inscriptions, in stone inscriptions, there's a move towards more geometry in the 680s, in some of the last dated inscriptions before the Dome of the Rock. So I think there is something happening there already, but the process really becomes full-blown at that point, at least that's my impression. And Al-Hajjaj, yes, seems to play a role in the spread of these new script types, and you can see it through the coins as well. Yes, please.
You mentioned in the early manuscript that there were traces of the lines that they used to
yes.
guide, and then you never mentioned it again. Am I to assume that they did not continue to use guided lines, or did they and they removed them in a better way?
Yes. Well, they didn't inscribe them on the parchment anymore, The only exception is the Blue Quran, because it's dyed, and I think they couldn't work in another way with it. What seems to happen is that they have a very fine treatment of the parchment, which makes it nearly translucent. So when you look at most of these early Qurans, by looking at one side, you're going to perceive something of the other side in any position. So we don't really know how they do it, but my idea is that they place a template grid below their pages, which replace the rulings and allow you not to have this trace on the parchment.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm wondering about the calf. I saw that the upper stroke, apparently in early times, was not developed. And I wonder whether that was true also of other letters, perhaps. Or anyway, why that change? Mm.
The upper stroke of the calf?
Of calf.
Yes. Well, all of the early examples I can think of do have an upper stroke, which is either vertical or slanting to the right. And what happens later on is that with the 10th century and these very angular new styles, they begin to play with the shape of the stroke until they start adding floriation as well. And in the Mus'haf al-Hadina, in the Quran of the Nurse, you can see as well Lam Aleph beginning to intersect in this way, so they become more playful with time. I don't know if that answers your question.
So, I had a question about the format of the text on a page. Mm-hmm. So my question is to do with justification, meaning that over time, especially from the first example that you showed to some of the later ones, the text is much more evenly justified on each end, right? Mm-hmm. Is the elongation of letters within the text related to the desire to even it out at the ends? Is that the logic behind which some of the letters are extended horizontally? Or?
Yes, I think that's part of the rationale for it. You're right. Another device that you have, this is one of them, and the other one is just to add horizontal strokes at the end of the line to fill the line if they can't do it any other way. So I think these two devices are used together for this purpose of creating a perfect rectangle. Yes, please.
Is there an analogy between the movement toward geometry in the text as it's written on the page and in movement toward more rigid doctrine or not?
I think there are two different things. The geometrical codification of the script happens under the auspices of the authorities. Of the imperial authorities in the late 7th century, at a time when the conflict, there are tensions with religious scholars, but there isn't a full-blown conflict yet. And it seems to arise from within a milieu of craftsmen, perhaps mosaicists with their underlying grids play a role in that. So I don't think they're related.
Thank you very much. This was really very clear, and now I understand it better. But I wanted to take up the question of orality versus legibility for a minute. Mm-hmm. I'm reminded of the work of Georg Schoeller, who has really given us a lot to think about, about the fact that no matter what you have as a book, the fact is that that particular book is known off by heart in any case. So the relationship between the text as written and the text as recited is in a different relationship than a recipe book or any kind of prose of any sort. Mm-hmm. And I wonder whether you couldn't sort of, because you're saying, well, this is legible. Was it ever meant to be completely legible, considering the fact that some of the words are actually divided into half at the end of the line?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, I think it's, again, it's you have to replace it in its context. It's legible for someone who's trained. And so the book isn't considered as an autonomous record of the text, but more as a kind of reference that you use. And as in the 10th century, you begin to have more people from more different backgrounds who need to read the Quran, then they become more closer to everyday scripts. You have less of these cut lines and of these more specialized, perhaps, devices in the calligraphy. So yes, I mean, it's very hard to be more precise than that because we don't have much of a record of how they looked at these things themselves, the people who used the manuscripts. Yes.
Thank you very much. Now, our next speaker is someone who is at the heart of our department, Maryam Ekhtiar. Dr. Ekhtiar is a scholar and specialist in the field of later Persian art, so we're going from one end of the date spectrum to the other. And one of her particular areas of expertise, however, is calligraphy. She received her PhD from the Department of Middle Eastern Studies at New York University in 1994 and has worked and taught at various museums and universities, including the Brooklyn Museum at New York University and Swarthmore College. She was co-editor of and contributor to the catalog Royal Persian Paintings, the Qajar Epic, 1785 to 1925. And she has been working here as a senior research associate in the Islamic department for about 8 years. She is co-editor of the recent catalog and the driving force behind it that we published, Masterpieces from the Department of Islamic Art at the Metropolitan Museum. And she's also published extensively in the fields of Islamic art, Iranian art, and contemporary art from the Middle East and North Africa. Today, she will be speaking on an illuminated book of prayers by Ahmad Nairizi. So, welcome, Maryam.
Today, I would like to present some new findings on an early 18th century prayer book in the Met's collection by the master of revival Nasr, or Persian Nasr, Ahmad Nairizi. I'll discuss the calligraphy, the dating, illumination, and the lacquer binding, and I'll then try to place it within the scope of Nairizi's larger corpus of signed works and talk about what it tells us about the workshop practices during the late 17th, early 18th century and the cultural milieu in which it was produced. The museum's A Book of Prayers has 81 leaves from two Quranic surahs, the Surah Yasin and Surah Al-Fath. Here you see a slide with the interlinear translations in Persian and Nasalir script, the red translations on most of the prayer section of the book. And you see that here as well. This was very common during this period to have these interlinear translations. And then you have the colophon. The manuscript is signed and dated on folio 57A by Ahmad Nairizi and is dated to Ramadan 11:27, which is August 17:15. The colophon mentions it was produced in Isfahan, and then the binding is also signed and dated. However, the date of the binding, 1720, is about 5 years later than the date of the manuscript. The manuscript is written in black naskh on an array of color-tinted paper such as stout cream, pistachio green, pink, yellow, brown, and light orange. Although the calligraphy is quite fine throughout, the most striking feature of the prayer book is its illumination. And these are two carpet pages from the prayer book. It has two sets of sumptuously illuminated carpet pages, one in pistachio green and crimson red with gold illumination and lettering in Virat script, and the other in eggshell white and crimson with gold outlining. Not all folios are illustrated. However, a number of other folios also have illumination, illuminated borders. Surah headings are elaborate. They appear in gold and silver against rich variety of colored backgrounds, including purple, blue, and orange. And this is an image under high magnification showing the silver illumination, the gold and silver illumination on a gold, on a purple background. The manuscript is bound in an illuminated lacquer binding, which is framed by an inscription about the benefits of prayer in revival Nas by Nairizi. The illumination on the binding echoes some of the floral illumination on the folios in the manuscript. The manuscript seems to have been originally made in two parts and brought together at the time of assembly. I suggest this because the colophon appears toward the middle of the manuscript rather than at the very end. The calligraphy in fine Persian nasr is noted for its clarity, elegance, and readability. Nairizi, who is credited with perfecting and codifying this form of nasr, was also instrumental in popularizing it and ensuring its wide use throughout the 18th and 19th century in Iran. This type of nasr is noted for well-spaced and formed letters with vocalization that is given as much importance as the letters. The dots and the shafts of the vertical letters give an illusion of height and allow for a smooth and rhythmic flow of letters on the baseline. Nairizi was responsible for transforming this script from an ordinary script that had been used in regular copying to a refined calligraphic script used in Qurans and other holy texts. The introduction of revival nasr was part of a larger movement in Iran in the second half of the 17th century, initiated by Muhammad Baqir Majlisi, who was Mullah Bashi, to make religious texts in Arabic more accessible to Persian-speaking readers through the insertion of interlinear translations in Persian and the use of a more readable text. Nairizi lived a long life of over 100 years and was incredibly prolific. He was active for almost 83 years, producing over 100 Qurans, numerous other religious texts, album pages, and exercise sheets, etc. His dated works span from 1676 7 to about 1740 and vary in character, ranging from luxurious illuminated Qurans, prayer books, and album pages in colored paper penned in inks of different colors, such as white and green, as we saw in this and in this example. His works are numerous, in numerous libraries and museums worldwide. The great bulk is in the Golestan Palace Library. Other collections that contain fine works of his are the Astana Quds collection in Mashhad, and other libraries in Iran, the New York Public Library and Chester Beatty Library in Dublin. And the Metropolitan Museum has two works by him, the prayer book under discussion here and an illuminated album page, with green ink on brownish tinted paper. According to one source, Nairizi was also responsible for large Qur'anic inscriptions in the Chehel Sutun Palace, dated to 1715. This shows that he was multi-crafted and able to work in different media and scales. He produced manuscripts, lacquer objects, such as pen boxes and mirror cases and book covers, and also epigraphic panels. Here's a steel plaque from the late 17th century, which is very similar to the pendant in one of the carpet pages, possibly suggesting that both were designed in the same workshop. This is also another one of these cut steel plaques of that period. That's, again, you can see the dialogue between the book arts and the works in metal. According to one source, Nairizi was responsible for a large Qur'anic inscription. And here you have these. Again, these are two of the pendants, and the carpet page. There's very little historical information or biographical information about him. There is brief mention of him in some of the biographical dictionaries, but the most useful information about his artistic career has been gleaned from the signed and dated works of art themselves. The Met prayer book was penned at a time when he was well established in Isfahan at the court of Shah Sultan Hussein, the Safavid ruler who ruled from 1694 to 1722. Nairizi left his birthplace of Nairiz in the province of Fars for Isfahan around 1688. His signature appended with the title of Al-Sultani in the colophon of a Quran dated 1695, presently in the Golestan Palace Library and other extant works, indicate that he was in the employ of the Safavid court as early as 1695 or even earlier. The colophons on a number of his works also indicate that in addition to royal patronage, he was also commissioned by other court members and wealthy and influential patrons. Like tribal chiefs, or there is one with the name of the Yuzbashi or centurion, etc. Although the Met prayer book does not include the word Sultani in its colophon, the date and quality of craftsmanship and illumination indicate the likelihood that it was made for Shah Sultan Hussein. In addition to being a master of an innovator of revival nas, Nairizi was also highly skilled in other scripts such as riqa, nasaliq, and shikaste. These are the pendants are in riqa. In fact, the inscription and the medallions and pendants on the carpet pages and surah headings are in superb riqa. The refinement and crisp quality of the calligraphy is accentuated by the contrast of the gold and silver against the rich colors of the background, as well as the colorful variety of paper. And these contrasts are what render this prayer book so luxurious and striking. The illuminated folios in the Met prayer book and the binding are not only fine, but flamboyant and innovative. They consist of an eclectic mixture of different floral and vegetal styles quoted from a variety of Persian, Mughal, and Mughal sources. Some are tightly executed, some are drawn in a slightly looser style, and some are quite schematic. For example, the illumination on one carpet page and a few borders throughout the text block consists of tightly drawn, dense grape-bearing vines framed by rows and columns of full-flowering plants. The second pair of carpet pages contains feathery peonies interspersed with spiky sawsleaf style illumination. The sarlo, the opening page, has a flaming design, sort of lobe design, in a typically Mughal Quran illumination style and palette. The illumination in the Met prayer book has been attributed to the famous illuminator Muhammad Khadi Muzahib, on the basis of its visual connection with the signed illuminations in the St. Petersburg album. And these are a few of the album folios with borders by Muhammad Hadi. It is well known that almost every leaf of calligraphy by Mir Ahmad in the St. Petersburg album has been illuminated by Muhammad Hadi and has been signed and dated by him. A group were dated 1747 to 1749, and the rest 1755 to 1759. Now, it's important to note that the date of the Met prayer book is more than 20 years earlier than the date of the assemblage of the St. Petersburg album, which makes a firm attribution on this basis somewhat tenuous. A more substantial piece of evidence linking the illumination in the Met prayer book to Muhammad Hadi is a binding, a lacquer binding of a Quran in the library of the Astana Quds in Mashhad, dated to 1732-33, in the field of which is decorated with dense pattern of grape-bearing vine scrolls, similar to those in the text block of the prayer book. And that is actually signed by Muhammad Hadi in the field and framed by an inscription signed and dated by Ahmad Nairizi. There you go. The gap in date between the Met prayer book and the Saint, illuminations of the St. Petersburg album and the binding in the Astana Quds suggests that Muhammad Hadi was quite young when he worked on the illuminations of the Met prayer book. And the Astana Quds binding, however, provides evidence that the two masters indeed worked in the same workshop, thus strengthening the attribution of the illuminations of our prayer book and a number of other works to Muhammad Hadi. It also confirms that the two masters worked together on a number of works in a span of at least 15 to 20 years, if not more. This bit of evidence helps us attribute the illuminations on a number of signed works by Nairizi to Muhammad Hadi. An example is a Quran manuscript that came up for auction at Christie's in October 2001 with a binding whose field is covered with the dense pattern of scrolling grapevines, dated to 1719-20, the same year as the binding of the same year as the Met prayer book. Looking closely at the illuminations in our prayer book, they are quite flamboyant and playful. It appears that the different styles are used simultaneously, even sometimes on the same page. Muhammad Hadi took the liberty of mixing a number of styles in these manuscripts and composing unusual and unique compositions. Scrolling grapevines coexist with full-flowering plants and schematic and almost abstract renditions of tulips. Grapevines were previously reserved for certain surfaces of lacquer pen boxes and mirror cases. Here you have a pen box by Mohammad Zaman dated to the early 18th century and a mirror case by Ali Ashraf, who was the master of Muhammad Hadi, with this kind of grape-bearing scrolling vines. Full-flowering plants that are traditionally used for the borders occupy the field of the lacquer binding, appearing in horizontal rows as they would in a textile. The style of the flowers and their compositional arrangement have been likened to those found in the borders of the small Clive album at the Victoria and Albert Museum, an album that was given by Shuja'uddin Nawab of Oud to Lord Clive during his last visit to India in 1765-67. And here are some folios from within the album of floral studies. The illumination, color palette, and binding all have a distinct Mughal flavor. The full-flowering plants are a common trope in many Mughal album pages, as seen in the Minto album and at the Chester Beatty and the Shah Jahan album at the Met and other Mughal albums. The repeats also recall Mughal floral textile designs and carved sandstone carvings of the Shah Jahan period. What Muhammad Hadi has done is, in the Met prayer book, is that he has minimized and simplified the Mughal floral designs and has mixed them and arranged them in a totally creative way so that full flowering plants occupy the field of the binding and at times are arranged diagonally in the interstices above the sarlo. Isfahan in the late 17th, early 18th century was a center for a flourishing center for Indo-Persian styles that permeated different medium from paintings, illuminated texts, to lacquer bindings and other objects. It was the milieu in which artists such as Muhammad Zaman, Ali Quli Jabadar, Bahram Sofrakesh, and Sheikh Abbasi were active. Several folios in the St. Petersburg and Met Davis albums feature the work of these artists. This was a period in which large numbers of both European prints or Mughal adaptation of European prints came into Iran and gained popularity and were absorbed into the Persian repertoire. However, by the time of the assemblage of the St. Petersburg and Davis albums, the experimental tendencies in the 18th century had subsided somewhat, giving way to a more reserved use of ornamentation. The grapevines and saws style motifs are strictly confined to the borders once again and used minimally in narrow step borders framing a painting in the same paintings in the St. Petersburg and Davis albums. So you can see that it is the narrow brown border. The Met Nairizi prayer book is much, very much in this spirit of eclecticism and experimentation. It mirrors the same eclectic aesthetic exhibited in the works of the artists mentioned above. The calligraphy is thoroughly Persian, but the illumination, the palette, are in the late 17th, early 18th century Indo-Persian style. Our prayer book illustrates the enormous creativity of both Nairizi and Muhammad Hadi, who pushed the traditional boundaries and created the basis for a new style that was transmitted to and continued to evolve in the Zand and Qajar periods. It shows the vibrancy and spirit of experimentation and innovation of the artists working in Shah Sultan Hussein's royal workshop. Thank you. I think that with the grapevines, scrolling vines, I'm not sure if the source is Mughal. It's Indian. It might be Kashmiri. I've been discussing this with certain colleagues, but we have no proof of that. This grape, scrolling grapevine motif is seen a lot in Kashmiri, later Kashmiri decorative arts. And this kind of dense pattern of them. I don't know that they have particularly Mughal association, like the same as the flowers. They're coming from slightly a different source. We don't know. I would say that some of it I've seen on earlier lacquer works as just, you know, decoration at the bottom of the box or on the side or on the inside, sort of secondary decoration. And somehow during this period it becomes primary and takes off in a more, you know, serious way. So. I don't know. I would not think that to make that association with these objects. Yeah. Any? Yeah.
I'd like to introduce the last speaker in this session. I think he's traveled the furthest today to join us. Dr. Jochen Sokoli received his doctorate in Oriental Studies from the University of Oxford, where he specialized in the history of Islamic art and architecture. He has been a research fellow here at the Met and in the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto. He's a fellow of the Royal Asiatic Society in London, and he has worked as a UNESCO curatorial consultant for the As-Sabah collection in Kuwait, where he's preparing the publication of the museum's collection of early Islamic inscribed textiles. He currently holds the post of assistant professor of art history and was formerly gallery director at Virginia Commonwealth University in Qatar, in Doha, where he lectures and he's curated numerous exhibitions and created public programs that have addressed issues of contemporary and historical cultural discourse. Today, he will speak on inscribed early Islamic Tiraz textiles as historical documents, a silk textile from Nishapur in the collection of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. So, welcome, Jochen.
Thank you so much indeed, Sheila, for your introduction, and thank you very much to everybody for inviting me. I'm very pleased to be here, Maryam and Navina and Sheila. It's always a pleasure to be back at the Metropolitan. Now, Today I want to talk about a little textile which really looks very unassuming, but it actually is very important, because it tells a story that isn't very easy, and slightly complicated at times, perhaps. And of course, early Islamic inscribed textiles are very dry, a very dry subject, so I'll try and make it as palatable as possible for you. Let's go to the right there. Now, the textile in question is one that is in the collection, and it is it comprises a ground fabric woven of silk warps and wefts. They are woven in such a way that they left a space for an inscription to be embroidered on in silk, which you see here in red. Now, on the back of the textile, of which I unfortunately do not have a photograph, the warps float behind the weft, and so that is how this area is being achieved. So it's really produced while weaving the ground fabric. And then later this inscription was embroidered. So it was embroidered in a space that was predestined for it, and hence it must have been planned, and there must have been some thought as to how long it should be, how it should be spaced, and so forth. Now, why is this textile so important? Well, it's a textile that is dated. We also know from the inscription who the individual was who ordered the textile. And there is a place of production mentioned in the inscription. And in such, it follows a whole range of textiles which we call Tiraz textiles, textiles that contain protocolary inscriptions of historical content. And there are about, I think, about 1800 to 1900 known of this type. There are lots of others with inscriptions of which we don't know the date, the individuals, places of production. And of course, not to forget to mention the name of the caliph, which should also be mentioned in the inscription. So let's have a look at the inscription. They're often very difficult to read. Let me see. Here we are. Okay. Now, I've highlighted the area which is the two areas which are particularly interesting. And I will try and find where they are. So, see, there we are. Here, this Abu. There, Ahmad, Abu Amir al-Mu'minin. So, Abu Ahmad, Ahu Amir al-Mu'minin, fi Tiraz, which is roughly here at the end, there's a fi, and then Tiraz, and there is a little letter here that is probably a mistake. And then it goes on, it gives the date and the place of production. And this is a matter of some interest, and I will come to that later. We will have a look at that in a moment. The date is is 266. So Sanat Sitta Sitin Wamitin. Now the name of the place could be either read as Bishapur or it could be read as Nishapur, and there has been some debate about this. Oops, I'm so sorry, what am I done now? Oh, there we are. And this is a, this here confirms the report by Nabuku Kajitani that this is actually a silk textile. And unfortunately, I didn't, this is the one textile that I did not photograph while I was here at the Met. So I have no microscopic photography of that. But I do, I trust Nabuku's judgment fully. Now, in 1952, Ernst Kuhnel, in his textile museum catalog, in which he publishes all the Tiraz textiles in the in Washington in the museum, mentions the textile here in the Met as a cotton fragment from Bishapur. And this is found in a reference to another textile, which he also attributes to Bishapur. Now, in 1992, an exhibition here at the Metropolitan Museum, which was organized by Daniel Walker and M.A. Froom, first floated or attributed the textile to Nishapur. And they took into account recent conservation work and textile analysis by Nabuku Kajitani. Now, the only other textile that has been to date attributed to Nishapur was one that Carl Johann Lamm published in his book on cotton in the Islamic world, which was published in 1937. And this is in the museum in Cairo. And unfortunately, I don't have a photograph of that. So this is the situation. There is kind of history of this, a debate. So it's moved from Bishapur to Nishapur. Now let's investigate that. First of all, let's have a look at the geography of the Abbasid Empire. Where are all these places? So we've got Nishapur here, we've got Bishapur here. Merv was the capital of the province of Khorasan, to which Nishapur also belonged, and then Baghdad, the capital of the Abbasid Empire. And you can see the distribution of the provinces. So Khorasan is here. This is the province of Khuzestan or Fars, and then the central province of Madinat as-Salam. Now, in order to evaluate whether we should, how we should attribute this textile, we should look at the broader picture. Now, we know that, for example, the capital of Khorasan, Merv, was an important site since Abbasid times. It was the base of the rebellion against the Umayyads under the general Abu Muslim, and we know that he built a Darul-Imara there, a governor's palace. And from then onwards, it was the seat of the governor of Khorasan. And at the time of Al-Ma'mun, in fact, it also was the center of the caliphate during the time that he spent there. We also know that it was a center of scholarship. For example, the historian Al-Yakut is said to have lived there and studied there, and several scholars of Hadith, Islamic law, and history have studied there. We know that Merv was a place of a mint, and that it also had a Tiraz. And these two are in fact connected, because minting is a prerogative of the ruler, because it mentions the name of the ruler, the place of production, and who ordered that, who ordered the coin. And this is principally what we find in a Tiraz inscription. And in early Islamic sources, these two are often mentioned together, in fact. And this is Merv, just to illustrate to you the place. Now, let's have a look at Nishapur. It derives its name from the Sasanian king Shapur the First. And it, for a time, became the capital of Khorasan under the Tahirids. And it was a very important trade emporium, and we know that from excavations to which I will come in a minute.
It also had a mint. There were lots of coins minted in Nishapur, and it had a Tiraz, according to Al-Maqdisi. Its textiles include, according to the literary sources, include fabrics that are called mulham, and I'm afraid I missed out the last bit here. And, of course, the evidence of the museum's excavations in Nishapur. And these are just some images here. You can see the excavation that took place before the First World War yielded very important archaeological evidence for a very high level of settlement in Nishapur. So these revetments, for example, are in the galleries, as far as I know. And there was, for example, marvelous stucco decoration found, important glass finds, such as this plate, which probably came from the central Islamic, from the central Abbasid Empire, very likely from Basra, where it's been suggested that these blue types have been made. So this was an import. Then metalwork, important finds of metalwork, ceramics, locally produced ceramics, such as this splashed ware here, or the calligraphic ceramics, such as the slip painted ware, and these very beautifully calligraphed ceramics, and this is another example here. And then, of course, also import wares, which were found there. Now, we should look at Bishapur in turn. And I'm sorry that this should, of course, be a dot and not a P. I didn't manage that with the program that I had. Bishapur was founded by the Sasanian king Shapur again. We know that it had splendid Sasanian palaces. It also was, in the vicinity, there were rock reliefs with imperial content, enthronement scenes, investiture scenes. It had a mint in Umayyad times. However, there isn't much coin evidence for the later period. And I'm very indebted to Stefan Heidemann for suggesting this to me. And in fact, it is the coin evidence that has prompted, really, to some extent, the rethinking of those attributions. According to the textile historian Sargent, who wrote a book on the sources on early Islamic textiles, he says that hardly any sources referring to Bishapur as a textile center in Islamic times. And the city seemed to have steadily declined after the early Islamic period, and it was probably a ruin by the 12th century. And this is Bishapur today, and these are some of the Sasanian finds here, these in the museum in Tehran, very splendid Hellenistic style mosaics, and here the investiture scenes, Shapur the First, and an enthronement scene here. So, where does this leave us then? There's a lot of evidence for the Islamic period in Nishapur and in Merv, which are very close and next to each other. In fact, they probably existed because of their vicinity to the Silk Road and as a mediator between the East and the West. Bishapur, on the other hand, seems to have been really an ancient capital and not very important in the Islamic time, in the Islamic period. So, why then should we attribute all these textiles to Bishapur? We should go back to our little textile, in fact. In fact, this is a blown-up illustration of the place of production. So, in fact, in Arabic, Nishapur is Nesapur, Nesabur. So, we could read it like that. Nun, Ya, Sin, Alif, Ba, Waw, and Ra. In the Islamic period, Nishapur was actually referred to as Sabur. And in coins, it is written like this, as if it was referring to a place like Bi Misr, Bi Sabur, Bi Achmim. So this B is not really intrinsically part of the name of the place. And if we were to add this B, Bi Nisha, Bi Ne Sabur, then we would have more. More letters than we do have in this inscription here. So this doesn't really work. That doesn't work with that. And we know that from the coin evidence. And in fact, these are early post-reform coins, and they all refer to the place as Sabur. And there are quite a lot of those in the early Umayyad period. And much, much later in the Abbasid period. Very much, much later, there's very little evidence for the Abbasid period, if at all. And this is an area I have to admit I don't know very much about, so I have to go back to that. Now, Nishapur, in turn, is always written. Now, where is it? There, here, Neis Sabur. And we do have a lot of evidence for that from the Abbasid period. And this is a very, very rare coin from Sabur for the Abbasid period. So I can't show you the whole of the coin evidence, but if you go through the catalogs, you will find that there is a lot of evidence for Sabur or Bishapur at the beginning of the Islamic period, and gradually a decline. And for a place like Nishapur, it really takes off under the Abbasids. And there's more evidence here. And I don't want to go through all of those, I'm afraid. Now, these are all the textiles that I have found that are attributed to Bishapur. There is one in the Taino collection, which was published in the repertoire, and I don't know where its current whereabouts are. There's one in Cairo. There's another one in Cairo. Another one, and this one here I actually can illustrate to you. This is in the Textile Museum. This one in the Benaki, another one in Cairo, one in Ann Arbor, which I can illustrate. Cairo, Benaki, Cairo, and two in the Textile Museum. And when we look at them, we find certain resemblances here. So these are those very tall elifs, these rounded letters. And I'm afraid this is not a very good photograph, but it's very similar to that. And then these are actually a little bit different. Inscriptions are a little bit more condensed in a sense, and a little bit more feeble, really, in terms of the execution. But those two and those two really also go together. Now, when we take our textile into account, oops, sorry. And then let's imagine that our textile was from Bishapur for a moment. And let's just remember that, because I will come to that later. The textiles that were produced in Merv, and I think we should look at them because Merv was the capital of the province of Khorasan, are following. There's one in the Textile Museum, which in fact has the same person mentioned as the individual who ordered the textile, Al-Amir Abu Ahmed Al-Muwafaq Billah, Ahd al-Muslimin, Ahu Amir al-Mu'minin. And there's this part that is very important here. And it's dated 260. So it's dated about 6 years before the textile in the Metropolitan Museum. This one is possibly one in Yale, which again comes from the Taino collection. is dated 277. There's one in Cairo, there's one in the Binaki, there's one in Berlin, which I can illustrate, one in Cairo, another one in Cairo, and another one in the Textile Museum, and then one in Berlin. So let's have a look at these. So this is the Textile Museum. And this inscription mentions that it was produced in Merv. And the fabric is a mulham, so it means, I haven't really talked about that, it's a mix between silk and cotton. Silk warp and cotton weft, and this is a speciality of Khorasan, as it's mentioned in the sources. And the same applies to this one. Now, this is slightly different than that. So you can see the same sort of dichotomy. This inscription is very much developed, very rounded letters, beautifully executed. This is a little bit more feeble, and it's also much earlier. And then there is this one here from Berlin, which is dated 287. This really conforms very much to that. Now, in order to evaluate sort of what types of inscriptions these are, I've just put together a number here that you can, this is our, that so you can compare. This is the textile in the Metropolitan Museum. This is the one in Berlin. So these are sort of, let's say, Eastern. This is from Iraq, and this is from Egypt. A whole different thing. So in fact, we might have a cluster here. Now, we should reappraise this issue because it really needs to be looked at. So, these two are attributed to Nishapur here. This is in Ann Arbor, and this one is in the Textile Museum in Washington. This one here in the Textile Museum is attributed to Merv because of the inscription. So is this one. But, in fact, if you look at them, they're almost the same. Now, on top of it, there is one textile in the museum here, which also comprises a striped ground fabric. And that has an inscription which loosely conforms to these Khorasani types. But that I would have to look at a little bit more. Now, and these are the two textiles, in fact, which mention Abu Ahmed al-Muwafaq, this one here in the Textile Museum, this one here in the Metropolitan Museum. And they are not exactly the same, but both inscriptions have this sort of same feeble character, very thin line, not really very calligraphic, as it were, as the others. And this is really shared with the textile that is here in the museum. So the question is, why does that have to be from Nishapur, given that we have all this evidence against it? Finally, we should have a look at who al-Muwafaq actually was. He was a brother of al-Mu'tamid, the caliph, and he was very important in pushing back and crunching the Zand rebellion of 877 to 883, which was a rebellion of black slaves against the central Abbasid government. And they almost were able to take Baghdad and crush the caliphate. But they were defeated by al-Muwafaq. And this made al-Muwafaq a very, very powerful ruler, in fact. So it is no coincidence that his name would have been mentioned on these textiles, whose inscriptions were a sign of caliphal power and of rulership. And so, to summarize, we have all this evidence that, I don't need to go through all of that again, but we have the rarity of silk warp and weft. We've got two textiles of that type. We have the coin evidence. We have the historical evidence for the scarcity of Bishapuri textiles against Nishapuri textiles. We have the archaeological evidence for Nishapur, while the archaeological evidence in Bishapur, I'm not aware of any, I'm really aware only of the Sasanian archaeological evidence, which has been published quite extensively. The styles of the inscriptions and materials attributed to Bishapur are really in line with those for Merv. And the historical content is also in line with what is seen on the one Mervian textile. So, in my opinion, this means that we have to reconsider this whole group that was attributed to Bishapur previously and look at them again. And we have to go back to Lum, in fact. And I'd like to just read you, before we finish, and I hope we have just 2 minutes. That's all. That's great. Because actually, Lum already pointed that issue, but he never followed it up. So, it is perfectly clear that the fabrics stated to have been made at Bishapur are not only influenced by, but clearly connected to those made in Khorasan, at Merv and Nishapur. And this to such an extent that one wonders whether the name should not be read Nishapur, a name which is to be found in its regular form Nishapur on the fragment AM8782, which I mentioned earlier, described above. The problem has many aspects, and I regret not having been able to solve it. In the first place, the difficulties in reading inscriptions of this type should be considered, clearly illustrated by the fact that on AM10399, the name of the Tiraz, which I read Bishapur, has been given by the contributors to the repertoire as Tinis, which is a place in Egypt. They're completely off. Although I do not intend to discuss paleographic questions in this context, in this volume, I must curiously mention here that the curved scrolls, which are so characteristic of some of the inscriptions at Bishapur, of Bishapur type, as well as the rounded form of the letters themselves, are obviously influenced by Pahlavi writing. Those who may find this assertion somewhat fantastic should study the undeciphered Pahlavi inscriptions, which surrounds the sepulchral tower at Lajim in Tabaristan, and which is placed above a Kufic inscription containing the name of Abul Faris Shahriyar bin al-Abbas, the date 413, which is 10-22-23, and the signature of al-Hussein bin Ali. So, in fact, I think he summarized it extremely well, better than I can, and I think this little textile here in the museum is a very significant one because it opens us a door to reconsider a whole group of textiles that, in my opinion, has been previously really misattributed. And thank you very much to all of you who've contributed to this, Daniel Walker and Stefan Heidemann, who've given me thought for this. And I think this really merits some further explanation and research. Thank you. Yes, I'm sorry that it took so long.
This is the question of an idiot. That I mean, I don't know the history of the area, but I wondered if what the significance might be. If it's Bishapur instead of Nishapur, what is it in the grander historical narrative? What is the
Well, in the grander historical narrative, Nishapur was a significant site in Khorasan, and so was Merv. Bishapur wasn't really significant at all, and therefore I'm suggesting that, you know, if we have so many concurrencies between textiles from Merv and those that are attributed normally to Bishapur, but could be from Nishapur, Why should we not consider the possibility that they were actually made in Nishapur? Given the fact that Nishapur was such an important center of commerce, of international trade, and that, in fact, these textiles, a lot of them have been found, which have been found in Egypt, would have made their way to Egypt through international trade. Does that answer your question?